beautiful.
It's the greatest encryption device in history, and the Germans use it for all major communications.
It's an untold story. It's a story that not many people know about.
For a new generation who don't know that much about the Second World War, let alone this incredible hero at the center of it who was so unjustly dealt with in the 50s, I think it was hugely important for me to try and validate that and stand up for his voice.
I think I first read about Alan Turing a few years ago in the paper, and I thought that it was the most extraordinary story.
He did effectively help win us the war. These people won us the war.
I'm designing a machine that will allow us to break every message, every day, instantly.
I always thought that the Alan Turing story was simply the most fascinating story in the world. There'd been films about Bletchley Park, but there'd never been sort of a really big, proper film about him.
We wanted this to feel fresh and have a propulsive vibe running through it, so it didn't feel like something you'd be assigned in school.
What is it that we're really doing?
We're going to break an unbreakable Nazi code and win the war.
Oh.
The script usually takes me, I don't know, an hour and 20 minutes to read, and this one probably took 30. You very clearly saw the movie, and it was written in a very intelligent way, and I haven't seen a character on screen quite like Alan.
What did you do during the war?
I worked in a radio factory.
What did you really do during the war?
Are you paying attention?
It's an amazing life story. It's one of those things that if you'd made it up, it almost wouldn't be believable that one person had lived through so many dramatic things, that one person is a genius and a war hero and invented the computer and was prosecuted for homosexuality and committed suicide. It's like all the movies in one movie. It's such a fantastic story.
Graham Moore's script was obviously the bedrock of everything we did, and one of the primary reasons that first attracted me to play Alan. I mean, it's a fantastic, brilliantly well-balanced narrative.
I love the script. It's funny, it's moving, it's, you know, it's tragic, it's intriguing, and it's surprising.
When you get a script like that, you find yourself reading it, and it takes you every which way. It's a very hard one to say no to.
I think there's something rather fantastical about creating a world that just doesn't exist anymore.
Every little detail had to be correct.
You're trying to find the essence of the period, the story, the script, and trying to maintain that through every set choice, whether that's a location or a set build.
Alan Turing, see Stuart Mingus.
Perfect, sir.
Locations were incredibly important. Bletchley is actually a museum right now, and the spatial capacities there presented some logistical challenges for us.
We had to recreate Bletchley Park. Now, Bletchley Park itself is quite visually interesting, but we wanted to, you know, increase the cinematic element, if you like. And I found this old RAF base called RAF Bicester in Oxfordshire.
This isn't a big budget film, and it's important to make it feel quite expansive and not to feel tight and contained. We added our huts, we built the huts, but we had other structures already there, so it didn't feel like we were three huts in a field.
And then we had to recreate the elements outside the main house in Bletchley Park. The huts were the right period, so we just did minor alterations to the exterior, but it kind of worked, and hopefully the jigsaw puzzle of Bletchley Park works in the film. Bletchley Park were very, very keen for us to go and do some actually filming there. So we filmed a sequence which we called the Beer Hut, and we used the ballroom of the actual Bletchley Park house. And it is actually where some of the social events during wartime were held. So it was a kind of nice symmetry for us. Benedict and Kira and the other main actors, they really appreciated that.
It was nice to actually see it and to be there, get a sense of the spirit.
Enigma is an extremely well-designed machine. Our problem is that we're only using men to try to beat it. What if only a machine can defeat another machine?
As a way to break the Enigma machine, Turing had built his own machine, which was essentially a precursor to the modern-day computer.
Turing created this machine called the bomb, which basically sped up calculations.
We had to somehow find a way of making this thing. So we need to create a prop that works visually, that looks like the real thing.
The original was sadly destroyed. So to give it the best chance of being believable, you know, you have to look at the real thing.
My name's John Pickles, and I'm an explainer for the bomb rebuild team. That machine is the Turing bomb. It's an exact replica of all the ones that were used in the war. And a number of people got together in 1995 with plans that were given by GCHQ and used the plans to come up with a master design for the machine that you see there. The main thing that it did was to help crack Enigma traffic. Now, during the course of the war, this machine helped with the reading of 2.5 million German Enigma messages. The codebreakers had to provide some of the letters in the message. Eventually, they discovered that most of the German messages were fairly stereotyped. They had a certain pattern.
What if Christopher doesn't have to search through all of the settings? What if he only has to search through ones that produce words we already know will be in the message?
Repeated words.
Predictable words.
There were things like weather forecasts. They would put the word weather forecast at the beginning of their message.
Exactly. They send a weather report every day at 6 a.m. So that's three words we know will be in every 6 a.m. message. Weather, obviously, and...
Heil bloody Hitler.
Heil bloody Hitler.
All you had to do was to work out where weather forecast went in the message, and essentially what's happening is that it's working backwards. Once you put some of the settings that you've discovered in the message, set the machine off, and hopefully you'll get an answer.
When it finds a solution, the machine will come to a stop. Once it finds the right answer, it slows down, puts the machine back to where the stop happened. The machine has now got the answer on these three gold drums here, three little pointers, and it's reading D, K, X. There's also a letter in the letterbox around the side of the machine, and those four letters combined together go into the checking process on a checking machine. They pass all the information back to the codebreaker in the codebreaking hut, and all being well, within half an hour, maybe 90 minutes, he would have found the setting of the Enigma machine for the day, the one setting in 158 million, million, million.
My God, you did it. You just defeated Nazism with a crossword puzzle.
Where we weren't able to replicate exactly, we've tried to do as closely as possible. And in some instances, we've made adjustments to make it slightly more cinematic.
The real thing is encased in a big Baker-like box, which is not a terribly interesting thing to look at. So we decided very early on that we would only ever see it before it was encompassed in its black box. So you actually see its guts and its entrails, which is much more interesting.
The quantities of components that have gone in here are a fraction of what the real thing was, but even those numbers are incredible. We're running currently about 5,000 meters of cable. There's well over 2,000 components individually that we've fitted into this machine, so it is epic in every sense.
The machine itself, I think physically in the film, takes on all sorts of kind of echoes of the human body. I mean, the wires look like arteries, and there's sort of faces to those dials. And when you open it up, it feels like you're sort of opening the rib cage of some beast, and there's another layer of mechanization behind that and then behind that.
The reaction and the cast have been fantastic. They've been so pleased to see it, you know. It's been kept hidden for a lot of people for a long time for obvious reasons, just to maintain that reaction, and everyone's reacted really positively to it, so we're very happy about it.
I spent hours, days trying to understand how the bomb works.
We get to a certain point and then another element comes in and we're like, and I'm back to square one. I have no idea how this works.
You will never understand the importance of what I am creating here.
Benedict Cumberbatch coming on board to play Turing, it felt like winning the lottery.
What I knew about Alan Turing, when I heard that Benedict was going to be doing it, I thought, yeah, that's very good casting.
He's very good at playing those geniuses, isn't he? He goes for some complex choices, which is interesting, because you don't want to take a character like this and just make him kind of black and white.
He's a phenomenal actor. He's believable, but riveting at the same time. So that's a very seductive combination to have.
My machine will work.
I think it's a truly unique and phenomenal portrayal of Alan Turing.
Despite the fact that a massive transformation would be made to go from Benedict Cumberbatch into Alan Turing, if anybody was up for the task, it would be him.
Benedict was very concerned to make himself look very different from what he's ever done before and as much as Alan Turing as possible. So we cut his hair in a particular way. We darkened his hair. He's wearing teeth to look more like Alan Turing's. So we've changed a lot on his appearance.
Alan's clothing, we've tried to recreate as much as possible from photographs that we found of him. And so we've made things and we found things and tried to fit them together. So they have that right sort of real feel to them. Benedict really had done a lot of research and he knew what felt right. So when he put something on, he could feel whether it was the right piece of clothing for him.
Oh, my God.
This makes sense.
Did you just propose to me?
We would have only been so lucky as to have someone like Keira Knightley be interested in being in this film and to play this very difficult but very special character.
Through Joan, we were able to get a lot of the fun bits of Turing, the smiling bits of Turing, the parts of his story that were really funny and sort of really charming. She has come in and just owned that character.
I know it isn't ordinary, but who ever loved ordinary?
She's a fantastic actress, Keira, and I think she got Joan's humanity and the spark of life. She was an extraordinarily strong character. So you need an actress of standing and of iconic stature as well, as far as the film goes, to carry that. And I think it's the best work she's ever done.
With Keira's character, Joan, I've made a conscious effort to try and have things not quite matching. So you've got different block colours together, and then a hat that doesn't match and a bag that doesn't match, because people only had so much then.
Joan's, you know, practical, kind of has very few clothes. Morton wants more clothes than I want. I wanted literally like 2 skirts, 3 blouses. That's it.
They were very academic people, so that is a secondary thing to them, that what they're wearing is not important as what they're doing and what they're thinking about.
It was a very well cast British film. Charles Dance and Anna Leach, Matthew Good, Matthew Beard, Mark Strong, you know, really, really, really great actors.
There was a moment on the first day where I sat there and I was just kind of, Jesus, it seems so odd to be a part of this group.
It's a great old cast. No one lets you down on this.
I think the talent that has been attracted to this project has been phenomenal. I feel really privileged having all these great actors come on board.
I got on with Morton really, really well. He's incredible. He's got a very, very, very strong idea of storytelling. I mean, he's great at holding the narrative of the film.
He's been fantastic, and he knows his stuff. He knows what he's talking about when it comes to the bomb and Enigma and what happened when and dates and this and that. And that's what you need when you're doing a period piece.
Being Norwegian, coming here and doing sort of such an important part of British history, you have to be respectful. And at the same time, I think it's a advantage to be somebody who can actually see it a little bit from the outside.
Let's go again.
He's one of the most enthusiastic people I've ever met.
If Morton's had his coffee, watch out.
He drinks a lot of coffee. It's a lot. When you see him with these things, they're about that much, and it's all espresso.
We just gave him decaf, and he didn't know.
They were sneaking decaf, and they were sneaking tea into my mug without knowing it. They started to worry that I drank too much.
But you've one thing left to do before your service to your government is concluded.
What's that?
Burn everything.
But the war is over.
This war is, but there'll be others. And we know how to break a code that everybody else believes is unbreakable.
There's always something about telling a story that is true that has extra resonance.
It's not a sort of period drama with a bit of dust on it, that it's going to be something that's going to kind of invigorate people because of the pacing of the story.
I don't want it to feel like a stuffy and very typical period movie. I want it to try and surprise. Because that's what Alan Turing is. He was a man outside his time.
I hope that the audience can feel that they understand this person who is very removed from them in history, in time, in place, and they feel like they've gotten a sense for what a tremendous human being he really was.
Now, if you wish you could have been normal, I can promise you I do not.
There are a lot of very big ideas in this film, and to carry them through with a kind of emotional narrative impact that an audience needs to kind of be pulled along with the drama of it is really important.
I wanted the movie to be, you know, a tribute to those who are brave enough to think differently.
Sometimes it is the people who no one imagines anything of who do the things that no one